Well, hi, everyone, and we're back here to the Neil Haley Show, and I'm excited to talk to an historian, Nancy Bartlit, and we're going to talk about New Mexico and World War II, which I don't have a lot of knowledge in. I have an undergrad in history, but sometimes we do not learn everything in history that's in the books, especially, and certain people that write things and research things, new things are out there. So, Nancy, thanks for stopping by. Can you tell me a little bit about your background first?
My background, I'm a history major from Smith College, and I have a master's in international communications from the University of New Mexico. I experienced World War II in New Jersey when I was growing up, so I understand what happened during those days, even though I was young. And I've lived in Los Alamos for almost 60 years, and so I know more about the Manhattan Project and what happened here. I taught school in Japan 13 years after World War II, and for 2 years to Japanese girls in an academy, and had many friends. And so I'm sort of in two cultures. I understand the Japanese way of thinking and the American way of thinking. And that's really important when one studies history.
And see, this is fascinating when you talk about World War II and New Mexico's involvement, and then you bring up the Japanese. This is quite interesting. So I'm going to let you take this topic and I'll ask questions based on it. So specifically enough, when you talk about New Mexico and World War II, take us the setting and what was taking place at that time.
Well, most people think of Los Alamos and the Manhattan Project, the atomic bombs, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. When they think of World War II. But New Mexico contributed much more than the atomic weapons. So I talk about four stories of what happened because we interviewed the veterans who came back, and these stories are intertwined. The one is about the New Mexico National Guard, who were federalized and sent over to the Philippines to defend the airport there north of Manila. And they held off the Japanese for 4 months. And we had about 2,000 plus there were other American troops, but they were using World War I equipment. And they were getting their ammunition out of the boxes for the first time when the Zero planes started dropping bombs on the same day as Pearl Harbor. They were heroes because they kept the Japanese from attacking Australia as they attacked other areas in the Pacific around the same time as Pearl Harbor. So there are heroes or POWs, only half came home. The other story is about the Navajo Cotalkers. The Navajo reservation is half in New Mexico and half in Arizona. And they shortened the war by a year because of their unique code. And I teach the code and the code within the code that explains why the Japanese could never break it. These were just a handful of young men on both of those. And then, of course, there's the Manhattan Project that started out with, they expected 30 scientists, and it grew to be 6,000 or more people working on the atomic research. And then the fourth issue, which is I specialize in, is what happened in the Santa Fe internment camp, where Japanese American men, immigrants and American born, were sent to Santa Fe to a camp that initially housed 400 units for the CCC and then was expanded to 2,000. And it was the men that were sent there were along the West Coast. They were picked up because of the supposed threat that they would be if Japanese invaded the West Coast. And they were sent to the biggest secret in all of World War II, which is 30 miles away from the atomic bomb research. And so there are many, many ironies. There are many lessons one can learn from just knowing this, these facts. That's a long answer. I'm sorry.
But that's a good answer. I'm going to go to the Manhattan Project for the time allotted, because I'm interested in the Manhattan Project. Because to first explain to people who might not know what the Manhattan Project is and how important that research was to end World War II, which some people, it's a controversial project, right? Kind of explain that for people to understand that.
Well, the atomic, dropping the two atomic bombs shortened the war. Definitely, because the Japanese were not going to give up. They wanted to have a huge battle in one of their islands and destroy the American military. That was their dream and their hope, and they were not going to stop. The Manhattan Project was called that as a code because it was started in New York City, in the offices of the engineers, the Army engineers. So it's really bizarre to have New Mexico and people with the title of a Manhattan Project. The scientists that were just exploring new information on how the atoms split, which put out energy, is just happening. And the country started looking at this research because the Germans were ahead of us in that. And so initially there were many universities where the different scientists were doing independent research, and the United States decided to do it in one place. And that they chose Los Alamos. General Groves was put in place. He had just finished building the Pentagon, and he was chose Dr. Robert Oppenheimer. Most people know about what you call him, Oppie. And Los Alamos was so remote from each coast that it would be hard for an attack on either coast to destroy our atomic research. The British had been working on the atomic research, but they came over with their scientists and their knowledge and combined it together. And in 28 months, we were able to develop a bomb that was uranium from Oak Ridge and plutonium from Hanford, Washington, that were brought to Los Alamos. And then Los Alamos set up in Tinian in the Pacific, the place where the atomic bombs could be inserted into the modified B-29s and be dropped on Japan.
So that's fascinating. And a lot of people don't know the Manhattan, when they think of the word Manhattan Project, that New Mexico had something to do with it, right?
It's one of the ironies. And Tinian is a small island next to Saipan. People know where Guam is, in the Marianas. And it looks like a Manhattan Island. So it has street names that are the same as New York City.
All right, so where can people find information on you, Nancy, and learn more about you and your knowledge of New Mexico and stuff like that? Where can they go?
I have a website, nancybartlit.com, or www.nancybartlit. And I have a book out that I'm upgrading. It's called Silent Voices of World War II. And the original book says, When Sons of the Land of Enchantment Met Sons of the Land of the Rising Sun. But people get, that's a tongue twister, so we're changing it to Silent Voices of World War II, Fierce Encounters with New Mexico's Fierce Encounters with the Japanese. And that should be coming out, I hope, in January or February, the upgrade.
Excellent. Such great information, Nancy. I appreciate you stopping by the Neil Haley Show. I learned something today. I always learn things when I interview people, but when it's involving history, especially the Manhattan Project, this is one that I know will be one that I will learn, will bring up all the time when we bring up the Manhattan Project in conversation. So thanks again for stopping by, Nancy.
Thank you for inviting me, Neil. And I could love to come back and talk about, was the second bomb necessary?
Okay, definitely send me some of that information. I'll definitely consider it because it's a great topic. So thanks again.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
You're listening and watching the Neil Haley Show, and we'll be back in just a moment.